Welcome everybody to episode 167 of the Startup Show. Today I'm talking to the CEO and co-founder of Arbrea Labs, Endri, and we are talking about computer vision, computer graphics. We talk about ETH and all of the technicalities around starting a startup coming out from research. We're talking all about Arbrea Labs and how cosmetic surgery will change in the future. Make sure you stay tuned for the entire video to see how you should be starting and get out of your comfort zone. Stay tuned for the video. Welcome to episode 167 of the Startup Show. Today, we are here at the Technopark, and I'm very excited to talk to the CEO and co-founder of Arbrea Labs. Endri, welcome to the show. It's such a pleasure to have you, and I'm very, very excited to hear everything about you and your startup. Please take it away. Tell everybody who you are.
So thank you very much, Cedric, for the invitation. It's a great pleasure to be here and part of your startup show. I've seen quite a couple of videos of them and really quite inspiring what you do with young entrepreneurs.
Thank you so much. I'll pay you later for that.
So maybe a little bit about myself. So I'm Endri, as you just said. I'm originally from Albania, born and raised there. And with 18, I moved to Germany to do my bachelor in computer science and electrical engineering. After a year of work, I decided to come to Switzerland to do it and pursue a master's in robotics at the ETH. I've been here for around 8.5 years. In September, I accomplished 9. I've been doing quite some internships and different jobs before I decided to start a PhD in the computer graphics lab, which is led by Professor Markus Gross.
Yes.
I finished my PhD last year, and during this PhD, had quite some ideas on what to do. And that's where we are right now with Arbrea Labs,
So maybe you said like you moved to Switzerland. What was one of the reasons like why you decided to move here besides the PhD or the master's?
Well, there were two reasons. First of all, I always liked to be challenged. In Albania, I was definitely challenged. However, I could see that if I go outside where the education is quite stronger than back home, I would get, first of all, a better education, but also challenge myself with the smartest and the greatest people that come from different countries. That's why I went to Jacobs University, which had people from 90 different countries. Most of them were Olympiad winners, so mathematical Olympiad winners, and that's where I went. The other reason is I always wanted to get out of my comfort zone, so I was feeling quite comfortable in Albania. So I said with 18, you know, I want to go out and explore myself in a new country. Sure. And I had quite some countries that I wanted to explore, one of them being the United States. Main reason why I decided to go to Germany is because was closer to home, but also giving amazing and outstanding education. So that's where I started. And then afterwards, I was working at the German Research Center for Artificial Intelligence, and there where I heard for the first time about this robotics master's program at the ETH, and that's why I came.
That's how you got here.
Yes.
Okay, so let's talk about Arbrea Labs.
Yes.
Arbrea Labs, maybe give all the people out there a quick pitch about exactly what you do.
In Arbrea Labs, we are developing a technology stack for rapid creation of digital human avatars on mobile phones. So this is the core of Arbrea Labs. However, our application or our business unit or our business direction is previsualization of breast reconstructive and plastic surgery. Mm-hmm. So I could actually go both ways. Why the first and why the second? So I want to focus a little bit first why it's important to have digital human avatars being captured from mobile phones. I would say that this desire started from my PhD. I was focusing on this specific topic, actually. So reconstructing of digital human avatars from single images, regardless of whether they were from the phones or captured from a camera, as yours over here. And then I realized that, of course, there exists a lot of scanners, but they're quite expensive and people have to pay. So one direction that I wanted to go is democratizing this process of capturing humans from mobile phones, utilizing the sensors that exist in the ubiquitous cameras that people use every day. And while trying to think of a certain project or a startup that goes in this direction, something very personal happened to me. So my mother was diagnosed with breast cancer and she had to do mastectomy. And during this period, I was very close to her and I understood how important is are the breasts actually in the femininity of a woman. And then I thought, well, if I could develop a tool that would help women that go through such anxiety before the operation mm-hmm. to figure out how they would look like once they undergo the surgery, that would be great. Of course, my background is technical. I cannot cure cancer, but if I could do something in this direction, then that's what I went for. So mm-hmm. initially, Arbrea Labs, so the first application, focused on practically on breast reconstructive surgery for cancer patients. However, with time, we realized that also due to implication of such of an operation, an easier route to start with would be just breast plastic surgery or breast augmentations. So that's where we are right now. We try to give doctors, but also women, a tool to previsualize how they would look like or what kind of potential surgical outcomes can come from a certain surgery. This is both beneficial to women because they visualize themselves less anxiety also. It minimizes the risk of them going for a second or third time in surgery. But on the same time, it helps a lot of doctors because they can use this tool in their consultations and mm-hmm. Also help with their conversion rates. So. Yes. Absolutely. That's where we focus on right now.
Let's quickly focus more on the basics of the startup. So yes. Like your team, you have a co-founder. I was told his name is Ben.
Yes.
So how did you meet and how did that work out?
As I was telling already, startup started in the environment of the ETH. I was doing my PhD. At this time, Ben came as a postdoc. At the ETH, and we befriended each other very quickly. And we came from similar but complementary backgrounds. And Ben also had a similar story to mine. And so that's how we actually thought about doing this. So I said, let's do this together. And we had the greatest pleasure that also Professor Gross decided to be part of the startup, so one of the co-founders. Mm-hmm. And that's where the genesis of our Arbrea Lab started. It was during the third year of my PhD, so almost finishing. And then once I finished the PhD, we moved here to Technopark. And then we decided to hire the A-team, people that really fit culturally in mm-hmm. in the startup and really are motivated to bring this product forward. We are 5 people, operational, but the whole team consists of 9 people at the moment, yes.
One of the big questions that is especially asked in venture capital is always like, okay, like it's very nice, you have an early stage company. Now the question is, what is your kind of like ambition to get to a $1 billion valuation? How will you get there? What is, let's say, your key point where you can say like, this is what will make our company very big?
First of all, I guess a lot of startups from ETH says that, but it's a technical expertise and know-how which is built in our company over years, right? So we have Professor Gross on board, people with PhDs that have a lot of experience and know-how which are bringing right now to the company. The second thing which is going to go a little bit more technical is that we try to have a tool or a software that runs locally on the phones, which means that everyone is going to be able to use it without necessarily leaving the images without leaving the phone, right? Locality is one of the biggest advantages that we have. The third one is that we don't require any external sensors for all the people to be used. So they can use the existing hardware that they have. Now, these are the steps that are going to bring us to a certain point. This doesn't mean that this one is going to make us the $1 billion company, but very important to stress here, at the core, as I mentioned before, we focus on the reconstruction of digital human avatars. And the technology that we develop is not only applicable to breast plastic surgery, but can be applied to many other verticals. One of them, for example, is virtual garment try-on. So try-on from home, from the comfort of your home, right?
Yes.
The plastic surgery itself is $1 billion market. It's been it's expected to increase by 2025 to $46 billion. And then the cloth market is $1 trillion market.
Yes.
So I think that at the core, we develop a very strong technology that can have many other applications. So we start first with breast surgery, and then on we can move to other types of surgery, face surgeries, and then to virtual garment try-on.
Let's talk about like the status quo of like what surgeons do right now.
How it typically works though in private clinics, so where plastic surgery or breast augmentations, for example, is booming, is that typically the woman comes and or the patient comes and then the doctor does a 2D Photoshop version of what she would look like. normally the patient comes and comes with some idea, like I want to look like her, for example, or I want to look like this VIP, or I want to have this size. And some of these wishes might not be realizable, and that's where the doctor comes in and tries to explain that this or this is not possible. However, just on a 2D Photoshop, I would say that this is not really the best way to do it. So that's where we come in. That what we want to do is we want to have this tool that the patient herself sees in motion, 3D visualization of her potential outcome as she moves and as the doctor potentially changes the sizes or yes. changes the types of operation that he can have. So this is, my opinion, the next level of plastic surgery previsualization.
Absolutely. When you say, I mean, like from a practicality point of view, let's say you use your smartphone, or how do I have to imagine this? Like you use your smartphone, you install an app, and then what?
So there are two directions, B2C and B2B. B2C is ideally you install an app, you place the phone in front of you, mm-hmm. and then you start, potentially capture yourself from two views, so frontal and side, and then just like that, it starts to track you and then place various breast implants realistically modeled with your texture and with the lighting. This is the B2C case. B2B case, what you could do there, you could connect, for example, to a big monitor, and the doctors could have this app connected to a big monitor and show to the patient live as if it was a virtual mirror.
Yes.
So this is the application in the doctor's case. Mm-hmm. So he would use the existing tablet, for example, that he has for what we call scanning, but it's not real, the standard scanning that we are used to here. So it's 2-3 pictures and then start.
Sure.
And then this can be connected to be visualized in the bigger screen.
Mm-hmm. And now, like on the B2C, I guess you do this for free for improvements. And on the B2B end, you charge some kind of licensing fee?
That's actually a very good question. So yes, on the B2B case would be a subscription fee or a licensing fee. And then on the B2C case, we are thinking of having a freemium model. So we're actually thinking of having a cloud version, which is for free, mm-hmm. and just provides you some basic functionality. However, the more advanced version that gives you all functionality where you might need to be naked, then this would be like based on in-app purchases, mm-hmm. or potentially even like have to pay for this app. Yeah. We are still thinking.
Sure.
We in fact plan to release such an app, hopefully July.
Yes.
So we want to release it in summer because we also think that summer is also the right time for women to try this on.
So it's exciting year ahead. Let's talk about the tech that you're using with it. I mean, you're using words such as AI, computer visualization, graphic design. So maybe you can break it down quickly what that actually means. And maybe, you know, bring in Markus with his Disney applications.
Okay, sure. I would be glad to go a little bit more into technical details. I try to keep it a little bit.
No. Let's go deep into it. Yeah.
What's very important is that what you need to do when you do this scanning, you need to do a 3D body modeling first of all. This is the scanning. So you want to figure out what the 3D shape is from a 2D image that you see. Second, you want to model the texture and you want to model the light. You might also want to model the pose, and above all, you want to track, right? Because as the woman moves or the patient moves, you want to be able to always realistically overlay this potential breast on her. Now, a lot of these steps require speed and accuracy, and that's where, so practically the first part is where computer graphics and computer vision comes in, but artificial intelligence comes in within all of them, in the modeling part, but also in the tracking part, so the way we track, the way we detect where the person is, the way where we apply, the way that we render an image which is virtual and it's not realistic. So they are all intertwined together. So the artificial intelligence or machine learning part of it, the computer graphics and the computer vision part.
Let's talk about like where you're actually standing with the development. I mean, like we spoke a lot about like where you want to be and how you're becoming big. And now what is the status quo? Like you said about something about releasing certain apps. What is working right now?
So in the B2C case, our status quo is that the tracker is working really well, and the modeling is working. We just need to put them all together in order to have like a full-featured app, but also that generalizes. That's the most important, right? So many women can use it. Like, we don't want that one woman, it works on one, but it doesn't work on the other one. On the other hand, on B2B cases, we're having various pilot phases, so with private clinics here in Zurich and then also in Latin America, as well as Unispital and Spital Mannendorf. So we are having various, let's say, test runs where they try our technology, how good it works on them first. And then, since they are so similar to each other, the development that we do for the B2B and B2C case is very similar. So we feel that by July, we're going to have the app out. Mm-hmm. And what we have in mind with this app is that the woman just places the phone and then presses play, and then she can start to move in front of it.
Right. Let's talk about what's currently going on, let's say, within this tech space, but outside of your startup. So like computer vision, I mean, like is a very developing industry. I mean, like, it's a lot of stuff is going on, especially at the ETH. It's a very strong research lab. Maybe you can elaborate a little bit quickly. What is currently computer vision used for outside of, like, let's say, Arbrea Labs?
The closest computer vision that is which is close to Arbrea Labs is all these applications right now over the faces, right?
Yes.
A very simple example, Snapchat or Snapchat filters is one of them. So all the masks that you put over there is one application. But then it goes a lot into augmented reality for makeup, augmented reality for plastic surgery, focusing on the face. Computer vision is, of course, is used a lot nowadays in autonomous driving, quadrocopters, localization, positioning. It's used into generating realistic data. So what I could say is that the computer vision and computer graphics have merged a lot in the last years. They are not anymore two kind of separate fields. They have merged a lot. And then there is this whole field or area of deep learning, which has been emerging recently. And now they are all coupled together. So there is a combination, there is a work between these three fields right now. Mm-hmm. So everything right now that is automatizable has some computer vision in it.
Yes.
And everything that needs to be visualized has some computer graphics in it.
Yes.
And everything that needs to be done, let's say, fast or could be learned from data has some deep learning in it. And they are all combined together. In fact, that's what we have in Arbrea Labs. So we don't have a pure AI solution. We don't have a pure vision, but it's a combination of all these different fields.
Yeah. Now we talked about like what the status quo is. Like, where do you see like these three fields developing over the next 5 to 10 years?
That's a good question. So I would say that probably, my feel is, most of that is going to be solved by AI or machine learning. So more and more machine learning will be used in order to solve standard computer vision or, let's say, old school computer vision problems, and in the same time also rendering problems. I don't want to get into much technical details, but there are latest research on GANs, generative adversarial neural networks, also the standard neural networks or deep neural networks that right now can replace completely rendering pipelines, but also can replace a lot of the traditional computer vision tasks like detection, tracking, and estimation, 3D shape estimation.
Let's talk about ETH. I mean, you cannot neglect that, like how important the ETH was as being part of the spin-offs of the ETH. But maybe you can elaborate a little bit how ETH helped you along this process.
Well, first of all, ETH helped me by giving me the opportunity to do a PhD at the ETH, right?
Sure.
It gave me quite some insights and deep expertise in the field that enabled Arbrea Labs to be created. I remember during my last year of PhD, I was attending some entrepreneurship courses, right? So as a person that comes from a technical background, this was pretty important to get into more depth of what it means to create a business from scratch. I would also continue that Arbrea Labs still is collaborating with the ETH, with Computer Graphics Lab We are having actually a bachelor student who is doing a bachelor thesis with us. And so there is always this constant interaction. I would also mention one person, Alex Hochuli from TH Foundation, who has also helped me a lot. So the network of him is giving me the opportunity to get some new contacts and potential clients. We didn't go the normal path. I know that there are many ways that you could continue to do an ETH spin-off directly from your PhD. And one of them is the Pioneer Fellowship. But we didn't go through this path. Initially, we got a seed round that enabled us or allowed us to go also outside of ETH, have our own entity in Technopark, however, while keeping collaborations with them.
I mean, you mentioned the seed round. I mean, like Markus Gross, he was part of the show also, and he is part of the investors. How was it to work with him? I mean, such a well-rounded person I rarely meet in my, have met in my life.
You just said he's a very well-rounded person. Not only is he an excellent professor, by the way, winner of his second Tech Oscar just recently.
Yeah.
But he has also quite some experience with startups.
Yes.
So he's also an entrepreneur and also an investor, as you just said.
Yes.
So I feel his help is pretty big in the initial phases, at least of the startup, and it has helped us a lot to get the right direction. So he has served as an advisor, but also as a lighthouse in the same time, right?
Yeah.
So yeah, we'll see. We are at the initial phase. It's just a year old, the company, and we will see.
Let's talk about the ecosystem here. I mean, like, I lived as an expat for 7 years in Israel, and I got a very good insight because I was not a local. And maybe you, even though you've been here for a while, you can elaborate a little bit on the startup ecosystem here in Switzerland and how you perceive it.
Well, I could divide it in a couple of points. First of all, it's a technical ecosystem. So because I'm a technical, Arbrea Labs is a tech startup, right? We are close to the ETH.
Yes.
This is really great, first of all. Second, a lot of these big companies like Google or Apple or Nvidia, they are based in Zurich, right? So this also attracts more and more talents from abroad, and networking really helps to bring ideas forward. Third, I would say there is this venture lab in InnoSuisse that really helped, especially during the startup growth phase. As a matter of fact, I'm just doing a course on startup growth, which is organized by Venture Lab and InnoSuisse. And on top of that, they also give you coaching sessions. So I would say there is quite a good ecosystem to start a startup, to bring it to a certain level. I've heard that you can get easily some seed round of money. I've also heard that going to Series A and Series B probably is a little bit more difficult here in Zurich, yes, in Switzerland. So yeah, I think it's a perfect ecosystem, at least Zurich, but I think Switzerland overall is becoming a startup hub. And yeah, so I look forward to see where this is coming. Yeah.
What is success in life for you?
Well, I would say, for me, success in life is having the courage to go to get out of the comfort zone. Once you get out of the comfort zone, then you improve as a person. You improve in the various fields that you are involved with. And this, for me, shows success.
How do you make sure you keep focused?
Well, I prioritize. So, I have a lot of things to do during the day, and you cannot do them all. So, you have to pick the most important task that you have. Of course, can be stressful to have to deal with startup. You know, you have to deal with customers and clients and emailing, which could happen on both sides of the world. But I like to do sports. I do volleyball and also occasionally play the violin. So yeah, okay. This is how I keep focused.
It's very good. How do you achieve a balanced life?
Well, that's actually a very good point. I remember from the very beginning of the startup, we discussed also with Ben, how we want to do it, right? You always hear that you have to overwork, you have to work long hours. And what we thought is that you are a machine that if you do a lot of over hours, you might burn out at some point. So
yes,
we decided from the very beginning to keep a good work-life balance. And how do I do it? As I said previously, I get involved in a lot of extracurricular activities, which force me to go there. This is the most important. For example, I'm also a volleyball coach. I train myself. I go dancing. I love to dance. And I go play the violin. So I meet friends as well. So this is a good way to keep the work-life balance, yes.
Very good. What is your best tip to get an investor?
Are you talking about the when you want to create a company or at a second stage? Because if you want to create just create a company, I think investors really look at the team. So make sure you get a good team on board.
Yes.
A good team means a team who is motivated to do what the goal is, but also complementary to each other. That's I think it's a good tip to get an investor.
What would you say is like your best selling strategy?
Honesty. Honesty, I would say, acknowledging the competitors and then understanding what really brings value to the company. So being able to show it or to tell it to the clients or to the investors. I would generalize with what I think I've been saying quite often today. Be courageous and get out of the comfort zone. This is what I would say that is the biggest tip that I would always give to myself, to my younger self, and to the new young entrepreneurs.
Can you maybe say like what that comfort zone is? How you can understand like, okay, like now you're outside of the comfort zone?
Well, you know how you feel
everybody when talks about
when
the comfort
you're
zone.
Out of the comfort zone when you try to take an action and you start feeling some butterflies there. That's actually when you're nervous, when you don't feel comfortable with what you're doing, that's when you're getting out of the comfort zone. So this goes direction. For example, for me, initially was getting out of Albania, right? Going to Germany and to Switzerland. It was a big endeavor then. Another one was doing a PhD at the ETH. And third, a dritte Stadt, Albanian here in Switzerland, creating a startup. This is also getting out of the comfort zone. I mean, we didn't talk about all this, but these are all decisions that you have to make. You can say, well, I'm going to be comfortable with my technical expertise and join a company, which is Google, for example, or try to do something bigger and create a startup. This takes more courage. This takes more...
Absolutely. So I think get out of your comfort zone, doing something bigger. I think that's a good way to end this episode. Thank you so much for being on the show today.
Thank you very much.
I really enjoyed the conversation. Thank you so much. Everybody who is out there, stayed all the way till the end of this episode 167 of The Startup Show. Make sure you stay a few more seconds so you see who is up next week. I see you there. Have a great Monday and a great week.
Hello everybody, I'm Tobias Reismuth, I'm the CEO and founder of CC Partners. I'm an investor in various cool startups. I'm looking forward to tell you more about what I do, about sustainability, about investing in clean infrastructure we do at Suzy, but also about those companies I have invested and in some I have a board seat. I'm happy to tell you my learnings over the last 12 years of being an entrepreneur, giving you the advice I can about work-life balance. Stay tuned, looking forward to seeing you next week.